This is True Crime Kent.
And we are back once again for part three of Joseph Callinger Op. Now, I know that the last two episodes, I've been saying this would be a three-parter. I know I've been saying it, but I was wrong.
Okay? It's only a two-parter?
I want to give the listeners, it is not, it's a two-parter. There's not going to be a part three. Bow, bow, bow. How does our song go? Bow. I haven't heard it since like episode three, so I...
It goes...
I know it starts out like... I don't think that's it either.
This is True Crime Kent.
Who let me do the intros?
Boots and pants.
I'll give the listeners a peek behind the curtain of TCK here for a second. Let you see the... What was it in The Wizard of Oz? It was just an old man right behind the curtain in The Wizard of Oz.
Old dude.
Give you a peek behind the curtain. Typically, a TCK outline runs about 25 pages after I'm done writing it. And that translates to roughly about 2 hours of audio after it's edited. Shout out to Chase. Last night, however... I did think this was going to be a three-parter, but last night, however, after I completely wrapped up writing part three, I realized it was 47 pages.
Oh.
And that would translate to almost a four-hour episode here today.
47.
And I can see just by Jess's eyes that she is not excited about that. Now, I'm fine with that. I would be cool with that. And I know the listeners are probably cool with that. But you know who isn't cool with that? Op, Jess, Chase. I've discovered that about 2 hours is the tap-out point for you guys in a single sitting. Op starts pulling on his shirt and getting Gilbert Grape hands. Jess starts drinking after about 2 hours. And Chase just kind of puts off an aura of fucking finished. It's weird because his facial expressions never change, his posture never changes, but you can just, he gets a glow around him. It turns from yellow to like black. So I called an audible on the play last night. I chopped today's episode in half and decided that our Joseph Callinger series will be a four-parter. There's just so much story here, and I did that for you guys.
Thanks.
That's how selfless I am.
Thanks.
I didn't do it for the listeners or myself. It was for you three. Because I knew that if we went over the 2-hour and 1-minute mark, there wouldn't be a single word of the story that would go in your heads.
Well, here's the thing is, like, Jess and Chase don't get to say anything. So they just kind of sit here, right? And then I sit here, and your scripts are so deep that my job really is just, I'm really along for the ride. And so I stress out the whole time because I don't want to be the, oh, yeah? Oh, wow. Jeez, that's crazy. I don't want to be that guy. So I'm trying my best to try to, like, you know, be present the whole time and being present while it's like being at a, it's like, have you ever been at a campfire and somebody's telling a story and then you're like, well, think I'm going to call it a night. And you stand up from the campfire and you forgot that your jeans were too close to the campfire and your legs are on fire because.
Yeah, that's never happened to me. I have a nervous system.
I don't. Apparently. But sitting for 2 hours at a campfire, your jeans start on fire.
Yeah.
Because I don't have I have proximity issues. So.
It's good we're having this conversation because I need to bring something up to you that's been hard to address for some time. You know what? We'll wait till after the show.
Oh, that's a stressor.
When we left Joseph Callender in part three, he was still living in his apartment shoe repair shop with his family, a shoe repair shop on the bottom, apartment on top. His schizophrenia had gotten substantially worse, and the hallucinations were almost a daily occurrence. Worst of all, though, was that him and his son, Michael, had just committed their first murder, and that was a 10-year-old boy by the name of Jose Calazo. You remember this, don't you, Op? They used some gardening shears to remove the little boy's member.
I was shocked at that. Like, I think what I said was something along the lines of, yes, Joseph Callender, but what the heck, little boy? Like, that's the one I'm the most worried about right now, is that kid's a psycho.
Yeah. And wait till you hear the end of this story in part four. That'll scare you even more. Yeah, and they had just taken the tip of it, too. It's like, there are better ways to get ahead in life.
Well, there wasn't the internet back then.
There was not. There was not. That's fair. Furthermore, so they killed 10-year-old Jose Calazo. Furthermore, they had also just attempted to kill Joey, who was Joe's son and Michael's brother. So Joe's now trying to kill his own son, Joey, with the help of his other son, Michael.
Also, a little bit of a dim bulb. Like, he's such a bully and such a jerk, that kid, that he didn't connect the dots as they're chucking rocks at him and, like,
no,
pushing him.
No.
Fuck you, Dad! Like, he's nope.
Humping the air, holding his crotch.
No self-awareness. Like, what the heck's going on? Like, my dad throws a rock at me or pushes me near a cliff. I'm like, you want to kill me, Dad? This kid has no concept of what's going on.
Just everybody in this family sucks, man.
Yeah. It's like the Herdmans from the greatest Christmas pageant ever, but worse because they kill people.
So I feel like we're caught up now, right? We can move on with the story.
Did that land? Do you know who the Herdmans were?
It did. It did land. You're doing good, buddy.
Yeah.
You're doing well. And I like your hat. How many alligators had to die for that hat? You look like the least successful member of the Duck Dynasty.
It's a cryptic camo pattern called Highlander. It's camo.
Yeah, I bet it is.
Sweatshirt from Target.
You look like one of the sons of one of those Duck Dynasty dudes if he just worked at Target.
And just talked about his famous family members the whole time.
Yeah.
Yeah. I feel like that guy.
It is 5:45 a.m. on Thursday, July 25th, 1974. And on this morning, Joe was laying in bed beside his wife, Betty, there, when he hears a massive explosion that makes him hop out of bed. He's like looking around. That explosion, however, didn't wake his wife. She slept through it.
Was she dead?
No, she's not dead, but as somebody who has roomed with you,
yeah,
you can probably relate to this woman, I would imagine. I'm convinced that you could sleep through the 9/11 attacks, even if you lived on the 86th floor of the tower, too.
I loves me some sleep.
It's almost, you need to see a doctor. You don't take naps, you take little comas.
It's a problem.
This explosion didn't wake his wife up for a different reason, though. It wasn't because she was a heavy sleeper. It didn't wake his wife because the explosion was in Joe's head.
Oh.
It didn't happen. It didn't exist.
Shoot.
Meanwhile, Joe's running from room to room trying to find the source of the explosion to no avail. And that's when, get your little board ready.
Okay. Oh.
God's voice came booming down from heaven again.
Joe, you ran away in Hazleton. You're not going to run away now. The explosion you heard was within yourself. It was a sign that you are getting ready to blow something up! Exclamation point.
Dun, dun, dun! Then, after hearing God tell him this, Joe felt some movement in the front of his britches.
What?
Oh.
Oh, no.
It was his little bird standing up and getting rock hard. And from here on out, Hop, an erection doesn't mean that Joe Callinger is ready to do sex. For Joe Callinger, from here on out, an erection means he is ready to do murder.
Wow.
That's right. Joe's little dick was his murder meter. And if his dick was hard, he was ready for murdering. But if it was soft, if it went soft, all the desire to murder was gone. It was like, if it went soft, just poof. It's like, I'd rather be eating some granola, I think.
Wow, that's a compass of a different kind. I'd make sure this guy was wearing gray sweats all the time. That way you know what's coming.
Speaking of gray sweats, you should see some of the videos that Jess has sent me on Instagram. It's bananas. Both in metaphor bananas and literal flesh bananas.
Why did she? I think Jess is the only person that can send wiener pics to men, and they take it as if a bro sent them wiener pics. Think about that for a second.
Well, I send her Britney Spears dancing videos in return. So
consider that for a second. A woman, just a woman, sends you a sexually charged photo or video. In your head, you're like, what are her intentions? What is she trying to tell me? But when
Jess is just a dude without a dick to say,
when Jess sends it, it's like, ha ha, good one, Jess. Fist bump. Maybe because it's offset by Jess's husband sending me drunk texts, happy Thanksgiving texts, all kinds. They're just a friendly couple.
This message, so his dick is now his murder meter, his little flesh compass for...
It's terrible.
This is already off the rails. The new message from God let Joe know something else. He has to kill Joey by explosion. That's what God told him. You were trying to push him off a cliff. No, we got to kill him with an explosion. And I think this really is a testament to how tough Joey is, because now he has his 13-year-old brother, or 14-year-old brother Michael, his own father Joe, and God trying to kill him, and he's already survived one attack.
Man, this guy.
So with this new epiphany from God, hey, I've got to kill him by explosion. Joe runs upstairs, shakes Michael awake, his son, his accomplice, and tells him, hey, wake up. Today we're killing Joey for realsy this time. He's actually going to die. And Michael's answer was literally... I'm not making this up. That sounds swell, Dad.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, the most Leave It to Beaver answer imaginable to the most fucked up news ever.
Should I finish my arithmetic first, Dad, or should we kill him and then I'll finish my math homework?
Golly gee, Papa, that sounds like a splashing good time. Let me get 5-0. Ruff, ruff.
You can see here on my slate, I've scribbled out a strategy.
It's a crown. So Michael and Joe, they meet down in the shop, and that's when Joe fills Michael in on his plan, and I'm excited to tell you about this plan. Down the road a little ways was the Nyhaus hauling parking lot. It was a parking lot for a company that loaded trailers, semi-trailers, and had them shipped off. And best that I can pinpoint, this parking lot was located at 2701 West Lehigh Avenue. And that was just a quarter of a mile from Joe's house there at 100 East Sterner Street. It's a tennis court now. But in that parking lot was a ton of fully loaded semi-trailers, full of goods. And this is 1974. I don't know what those goods would have been. Probably like butt jiggler machines.
Yeah.
Bunch of stuff to put odd foods in Jell-O. I don't know why we were obsessed with that in this. Hey, you ever had Spam in Jell-O?
Jell-O was one of the newest innovations. That whole time period, Betty Crocker was changing the world because, like, if you wanted to make a cake back then, it took a lady a long time. But Betty Crocker was like, here, just dump this box in, put an egg in with some water, and you're good. Like, things were changing on the domestic front.
I want you to keep talking. I'm excited to see where this is.
Three words into me starting that, I thought,
I want to see how long it takes you to say, we need to make America great again.
I started talking and instantly realized you have a whole script of research to get to, and I'm talking about Betty Crocker, so.
I mean, I've got titties. I love Betty Crocker.
I'm just going to settle back into my normal pattern. Wow, what? That's crazy.
So at this parking lot, this Nyhaus Hauling parking lot, it's loaded with semi-trailers. Joe tells Michael, hey, we're going to send Joey into one of those stuffy, full trailers with a bunch of gasoline under the guise that he's going to steal some shit and then burn them down. What they're going to do, though, is make sure that these gasoline cans don't have lids on them.
Oh, so that they're exposed.
So that they're exposed, they're sloshing around. That way, Joey, you know, he's got to walk down there with these. They're sloshing around. It's going to get on them. And Joe explains to Michael, listen, your brother, he's a clumsy, dumb fucking idiot. On the way there, it's going to slosh and get on him. And then he explained to Michael that when Joey gets in that trailer, he will, without a doubt, light a cigarette. Because he chain smoked. Joey was a chain smoker, 12 years old.
And the kid was?
Yes. Chain smoker. Not making this up. He says, when your brother gets in there, Michael, he's going to be covered in gas, and he's without a doubt going to light a cigarette. And that's going to be the end of Joey, of Little Fonz. Little Fonz is going to, we don't have to do anything. He's going to kill himself. We're just going to set him up. We're going to set him up. He's going to knock himself down. As far as Michael and Joe saw, you know, Michael hears this. He's like, God, Dad, that's a bulletproof plan. This is foolproof. It's honestly, when I describe it, rock solid Elmer Fudd plan.
Also, the faith that they have at what a doofus Joey is. Like, he's going to inevitably get gas all over his body.
Yeah, there's a lot of
presumption.
Like, yeah.
Okay. All right, Dad.
These two fucking idiots just planning this. We're going to get this wascally rabbit. Now, Michael, he's extremely excited about this new plan. He runs upstairs, shakes Joey awake, and lets him know, hey, Joey, wake up. We got work to do. Dad's got a cool idea. Meanwhile, downstairs, Joe Callinger gets two empty glass half-gallon spring water bottles. So these, you know, half-gallon giant glass water bottles. He fills them up with gasoline and leaves the lids off of them intentionally. The wildest thing, honestly, to me about this entire story was me learning that we had bottled water in the 70s. I thought that prior to the 80s, everybody just lived off milk and beer. I didn't even know that we knew that you should drink water.
Well, they did. Yeah, I mean, but there was delivery of milk. You know, water didn't seem to be it wasn't marketed. Definitely, I don't think it was marketed. No.
I actually looked this up because I was curious about it, and it turns out water is actually one of the oldest bottled things in human existence. It goes back to like the 1600s, 1700s that we've been bottling water.
Really?
Yeah.
That's crazy. I would not have thought, I would have thought that was a much more modern thing because we're idiots nowadays and we'll spend, $6 on something that's free.
Nope, we've been idiots forever. So Joe's filling these 2 half-gallon glass water bottles with gasoline, leaving the lids off of them. He puts them into a plastic bag so that they're good and sloshy. So this poor kid's got to carry them by the handles of a plastic bag. And then it takes another bag and puts matches and a flashlight in it. Eventually, the three of them meet back down in the shop. So you got Michael, Joey, and Joe. Joey's smiling from our victim, smiling from ear to ear, thinking, what a great morning. I'm going to do a burglary and an arson on a Thursday morning right before school, too. Neat. Gosh, this sure is a swell morning, Pops.
He's the only kid probably in his school that also completely understood the word alibi.
Oh, for sure.
My dad's my alibi.
Because there's so much to this story that I couldn't possibly say everything. It'd be a 10-part story, but one of their favorite pastimes was Joe and Joey would sneak out and graffiti things, including Joey's school, which was Joe's idea.
What a crazy person. Do you think there's enough on Joey alone to do like an episode on its own?
Listen, man. There's enough on Joey alone to do an episode of its own. There's enough on Michael alone to do an episode on its own. There's enough probably on Betty alone to do an episode of its own. I would actually like to do a separate Joe Callinger series, but just from the point of view of Betty.
Oh, that would be interesting. That would be interesting.
So Joe, he hands Joey these two bags. One has sloshing bottles of gasoline in them. The other bag has the matches and the flashlight, and he sends the boys on their way. He tells them, hey, go down to the trailers, scope them out, find a way in, and then come back and get me so I can come and help. Joe then goes upstairs and watches from his bedroom window as the boys walk down the street towards the parking lot, which was like just out of view. The whole time he's watching them, rock hard dick. Just a rock hard, just so hard. It might pop. It's so hard. And this isn't a sexy boner. This is a raging murder boner. That's important. Murder boner, not a sexy boner.
I already am dreading the cover art that's going to be drawn for this episode.
Shout out to Mark Williams.
Oh, gosh. So many penises. Oh.
So Joe watches and watches. And a few moments later, here comes Michael walking back down the street. And Joey's not with him. When he gets up to the apartment, he fills Joe in on where they're at. What's the current status? He says, hey, Dad, the semi-trailers, they were backed up a few feet from a brick wall. So these semis in this parking lot, probably to deter adults from trying to get into them and stealing the goods, I would imagine. But these are kids.
Preventing the doors from being opened fully.
Yeah, but they're little kids. They can get this back door open to this semi-trailer enough to squeeze in. They found one, and they were able to get that door open. Joey climbs in and squeezes in. He takes the bag of gasoline, which, to be fair, was all over him.
That it worked is amazing. It's shocking.
Yes. Joey walks to the back of the semi-trailer, sets the bag of gasoline down, and then comes back to get the matches from Michael and the flashlight. On his way back to the rear of the trailer, Michael yells to him, "Hey, I'm going to go get Dad now. I'm going to shut this door." And Joey's like, "Yeah," he's probably like, "Yeah, that sounds like a swell idea, Mike." What Joey didn't know was Michael intended on locking him in there. There was a problem, though. This is a semi-trailer. Keep in mind, they're what, 4 foot off the ground before the bottom of the trailer even starts, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Michael isn't tall enough to lock his brother in the trailer. So instead, he finds an old steel milk crate laying around there in the parking lot and wedges it between the door and the brick wall there to keep it from opening. I mean, for a young, already proven dumb child, pretty smart.
Yeah.
Good improvising.
Yeah, some engineering skills there.
And then he left, certain that Joey would soon be lighting a cigarette and ending his own life. Now, back at the apartment, Joe and Michael are watching towards the parking lot for smoke from the upstairs window. Unfortunately, though, Joe's little bird had gone soft. Now he wasn't so excited about murdering his son again, just like at the cliff. He had murder erectile dysfunction. Just seeing him talking to a doctor. "I don't have problem getting it up for the murder. It's keeping it up, doc." The way he figured it, though, even though he's standing there with a small little shriveled bird, he was too late. So it is what it is. Joey's just going to have to die, I guess. Now, as crazy and stupid as this plan did admittedly sound, unfortunately, smoke does soon start billowing up. Huge black clouds of smoke are coming out of the trailer that Joey is inside.
Wait, I'm missing a part, though. Who lit it on fire?
We're going to get to that. Give me just a second.
Okay, because I'll just remember Mike's trapping him in there.
Yeah, he's trapped in there.
Okay, all right, okay, all right.
It turns out, spoiler alert, they were 100% correct about Joey's dumbass.
Dang it. This bodes not well for a team of murderers who think that they can predict people's behavior and have them kill themselves. We're geniuses.
Huge black clouds are billowing out of that trailer that Joey was inside. Excited, Joe and Michael go downstairs to the shop, sit, and wait for the news to inevitably come pouring in that the trailers at the Naha's parking lot are on fire and somebody is dead inside. At 6:38 a.m., this is less than an hour after Joe got the orders from God. 6:38 a.m., fire trucks come flying by the house. After they saw the fire trucks, Joe and Michael began celebrating silently together down in the shop. Joey was dead. So they're down there. It's early in the morning. They're celebrating. Joey is dead. And up. That's when the front door busted open to the shop. And silhouetted there in the frame was little Joey Callinger.
Oh, wow. Resilient bugger.
I'm so excited for this next part. His face was covered in black soot, and the bottom of his pants and shoes were burned. Joe and Michael's mouth hit the floor, and Joey said, quote, "Woo, guess I lit it too early, guys." He then walked over, hopped up and sat down on a counter and lit a cigarette.
Uh.
just to be a fly on the wall in this room. Michael and Joe staring at each other in silence. Joey's sitting there on the counter swinging his feet back and forth, smoking a cigarette, probably singing like, bad, bad, Leroy Brown, baddest cat in the whole damn town. Head smoking. Eyebrows missing.
He looked like Buckwheat from The Little Rascals. Yep. Just...
Yeah. Unintentional blackface.
Oh, jeez.
Now, they have to take a moment. Michael and Joe have to take a moment to gather themselves because they're like, what the fuck? What is going on? And that's when Joey fills them in on what happened. He said, hey, I got bored waiting for you and Michael to get back. So to fill the time, I started pouring little puddles of gasoline out in the trailer and flicking lit matches at him.
Not even thinking about the lack of oxygen he was just, or the oxygen he was just sucking up.
No.
Wow.
So we made fire after little bitty fire beside these giant bottles of gasoline. The flame, though, because he kept pouring it out and taking it back and pouring it out, the flame eventually followed a dripping trail and ignited the bottles, causing an explosion inside the
trailer. Jeez.
In the explosion, because he had sloshed the gas all over the bottom of his pants and shoes caught on fire. He then ran full speed at the back door with his pants and shoes on fire, hit it with all the weight of his little body, which jarred the milk crate loose that Michael had wedged between the wall and door. The door opened enough for him to squeeze out, hop out onto the ground, and get the fire out on his shoes and pant bottoms.
So it's likely he didn't even notice the wedge in the door.
No.
Because he was distracted by just getting out.
Even if he did, it's not like this kid possesses the facilities to put two and two together.
Yeah.
With soot on his face, keep in mind, looking like Wile E. Coyote after getting fucked up by the Roadrunner, walks across the street to a place called Sam's Luncheonette that was located at 150 West Lehigh Avenue, and calls the fire department. Now, Sam's Luncheonette is a Mexican restaurant now. It's called Mis Viejos Restaurant and Lounge. Same building. And after calling the fire department, he just walks home.
So he called the fire department too.
Yes.
This is fun.
And that was that up. The boys went to school and Joe went to work.
Oh, man.
Despite two of their best efforts, 13-year-old Joey Callinger was still alive and well and still absolutely oblivious to the fact that his father and brother were trying to murder him.
Oh, my gosh. I don't know if to jeer or cheer for that kid.
You do kind of want to cheer for him. He's like a little miniature fucked up version of Iron Mike Malloy.
Yeah. Yeah. He's unkillable at the moment. And I'm kind of like, good for you. Terrible boy.
3 days later, op at 3 p.m. on Sunday, July 28th, 1974, Joe's sitting at his workbench in his shop. And that's when he gets another message from God.
Oh, here we go.
Killing Joey is right. Find a hole and kill Joey in it. Joey is a demon, and he is filled with evil. He's also a fag.
That's in the script. That's what God said. And I think that's not cool, God.
Dang it. He's also a fag. His body is dirty from arming and legging it with other boys, from taking their dripping penises into his mouth, taking their hard... man.
Read it, God!
Taking their hard bones up his ass. Ugh.
And I didn't add the According to Joe, that's what God said. Yeah, that was verbatim what God said. Taking their hard bones in his ass.
Ugh. Wow. Ugh. Who knew God made those exclamations? Full body chills with that kid. Ugh.
On this, Joe drops his head and says back to God,
"It's going to happen this afternoon."
Like, aw.
"It's going to happen this afternoon, God." Jesus. I mean, geez.
So when God says, "Hey, it's going to happen this afternoon," God says this.
"Today, Joey. Tomorrow, the world. You and Michael, your second in command, will commit global massacre. You'll kill every member of the filthy human race. Then you'll wipe out your family, what's left of your whole rotten crew. Finally, you'll kill Michael. Then, yourself."
He kind of gave too much of the plan away, I feel like, there to Joseph.
Yeah. God really doesn't keep any cards in his pocket. He sounds like a James Bond villain describing his evil plan to James Bond in a trap that he will inevitably get out of. "You can't escape this one, Bond. Here's my entire plan. Now I shall leave this room without actually seeing you die." Now, with this epiphany from God, Joe considered something. Op. That demon that had been living in his little bird when he was little, it had probably grown inside him. It had been a baby demon when he was a kid because he was a kid. It was a kid demon, and it lived in his penis, but as he grew, the demon also grew, but his penis stayed the same size. It was small. His little dick stayed small, and in Joe's head, that meant the demon outgrew his little dick, and because it outgrew his small little dick, now the demon was in his whole body.
Wow. This guy's processing a lot. It's really... stealing.
I'm honestly glad I just have to worry about Israel and Palestine. This is a lot. This is a whole lot.
A lot to deal with on your own, too. Just alone in your head.
Yeah. You're trying to kill your son. He's being stubborn. God won't leave you alone. You're trying to fulfill your shoe repair orders.
You've got tests being run on hamsters. Come on.
Hamsters. Little bitty shoes. They're so hard to sew. He's not a tailor. He's promised little suits.
Why does his whole crazy plan, though, sound like something I'd devise for 1159?
It really does.
We'll do suits. We'll do little suits. I don't know how to make them, but we will.
Hamster suits. We'll sell like hotcakes. Jess, find a tailor. With little hands. So at this epiphany, after this epiphany, hey, this demon, it's outgrew my little penis. Now it's in my whole body. After this, Joe gets one of his most vivid visual hallucinations he had ever gotten up until this point. He sees himself standing on a mountain high above cities and farms and oceans, this huge mountaintop he's on. And he starts pointing his finger at these cities and farms and oceans. And the second he decides where, these cities and farms and oceans are immediately destroyed by hurricanes and earthquakes and fire. And people scream as they die. And Joe is deciding all this. He sees himself as this. And then behind him on this mountaintop, lightning strikes. And out of that bright light flash stepped Super Joe.
Super Joe?
It was.
What?
It was. Joe realized how he would look as a god in the afterlife.
Wow.
And I'm so excited to describe this. Super Joe had great posture.
He leads with, like, the number one thing that a superhero coming out of, like, a reform school would have.
His diction was perfect. His posture impeccable.
Okay.
He was wearing pants and a shirt that were made completely out of fire.
All right.
And he's really just describing Joey at this point. But here's my favorite part about Super Joe Up. Written on the back of his shirt in letters of bright ice amidst the flames was, quote, "The Callinger Rapid Shoe Repair Pickup and Delivery Service."
Oh, my goodness. Are you kidding me? So Super Joe...
I wish I was making this up. I'm not.
Super Joe's just a marketing pitch?
In the afterlife.
I guess they still wear shoes in the afterlife, apparently. Oh, my goodness. What an idiot.
It was because of this vision that Joe realized he wasn't under the control of a full-grown demon that had outgrown his penis. That's ridiculous. That wasn't the case at all. He was just meant to be a god in the afterlife, a god that could destroy entire cities with the snap of his fingers, a god that was all-controlling, decided who lived and who died, and a god that also worked as the owner and manager of the Callinger Rapid Shoe Repair Pickup and Delivery Service. In the afterlife. And I think that's silly because everybody knows that everyone wears flip-flops in heaven. He could only have his shoe repair business in heaven, though, and become a god if he could kill everybody on earth.
Who is he servicing in heaven? I guess he kills everybody, and then they're in heaven, and he's like, "So you don't have a choice. If you got to have shoe repair, I know I killed you guys, but you got to use my business."
Yeah, it's called capitalism.
Oh my gosh!
So because he has to kill everyone on earth, which is, to be honest, if you're at work and you think your boss is hard on you, you got to fulfill this order or fill out this paperwork. At least he's not ordering you to kill every human being on earth, because that is a
tall, tall order.
Oh. And by the way, Joe has no intentions of mass murder. It's one by one.
Yeah, he hasn't really thought that part through, has he? How exactly he's going to do this is not top on his list.
But because he has to kill everyone, Joey has to die. He's going to be first. And as far as Joe saw it, Joey was the test. Like, if I can kill one of my own, Like, I could kill anybody, you know. On this very same day, he corners Michael in the store and says, quote,
"Today's the day. We're actually going to kill Joey today."
I'd start to not believe my dad.
And Michael, of course, is like, "Hell yeah, Pops. Let's do it." Joe says, "Hey, go find Joey. And then we're all going to meet at the OK restaurant." That was the name of the restaurant. The OK restaurant.
Setting the bar low.
That's the name of it. OK restaurant. Meet me. Get Joey. Come meet me at the OK restaurant. That restaurant was located at 2401 North Front Street. And it was just under a quarter of a mile walk from the Callinger home. And yeah, like you said, that name is honest advertising, and I respect that. We're not the best. We're not the worst.
There's a used car dealership in town I love. It's a used car dealership. The name's Fairly Reliable Bob's. And they slay it. They really do.
I love it.
Fairly Reliable Bob's.
Like one out of every four is a lemon. And they're honest about that. Somebody brings it back and they're like, "Yeah, you get that.
Who knew?" We knew, but who knew?
It happens. That's where the Fairly comes in. Now, that location where the OK restaurant was is now same. It's the same building, but it's now K-Fish Comestibles. Okay. Just a grocery store. Joe tells Michael, "Hey, from there at the OK restaurant, we'll find a place to kill Joey. We'll wing it. We're going to wing it." Michael runs off to go find Joey, and while he does that, Joe cleans up, puts on a fresh pair of clothes, and then goes down to the basement, gets a bag. It was a bag to carry shoes in, and puts four long chains in it, four locks, a camera, and three flashlights into that bag. He then leaves with the bag for the restaurant, and there at the OK restaurant, he meets Michael and Joey. Now, the three of them get a booth. They order some burgers and fries. And at one point during the meal, Joey asks his dad for a quarter for the jukebox. Joe refused at first, but then Michael, his brother, leans over and whispers in his dad's ear, quote, "Ah, come on, Dad. Let him have it. It's his last time." Did I say quarter?
Yeah.
It wasn't a quarter. It was a nickel. That's going to bother me if I don't correct that. I had to do a bunch of currency conversions and fucking bullshit to determine how much a jukebox would cost in 1974. So I'm not going to forget that detail. It was a nickel.
And then you got on eBay and were looking for used jukeboxes, huh?
They're very pricey.
Yeah.
At the jukebox, Joey picks Seasons in the Sun by Terry Jacks. And the three of them sit there at the booth and eat their burgers and fries while Joey sings it. And these, I shit you not, are lyrics from that song. And I'm not going to sing them because I'm going to play an excerpt from the song after this. But these, just so you know what he's saying, consider the situation here, what's getting ready to happen, and the lyrics, the song that Joey picked. "Goodbye, Papa, please pray for me. I was the black sheep of the family." And it's important to note that Joe said that at this part of the song, Joey's singing it, he says, "I was the black sheep of the family." He said he leaned over to them and said, "That's me, Dad. I'm the black sheep of the family."
Oh.
"I was the black sheep of the family. You tried to teach me right from wrong. Too much wine and too much song. Wonder how I got along. Goodbye, Papa. It's hard to die when all the birds are singing in the sky. Now that the spring is in the air, little children everywhere, When you see them, I'll be there. We had joy, we had fun, we had seasons in the sun, but the wine and the song, like the seasons, have all gone. It's honestly, I know it sounds like a depressing song and the lyrics are, but it's pretty catchy. It's like a catchy, upbeat song. Kind of like Pumped Up Kicks.
Like, oh my gosh, I was just thinking of that song. I was thinking, this reminds me of a dark, creepy...
I remember the first time I loved that song, but I'd never really listened to the lyrics. I was just singing in the car, and I went, wait a goddamn minute. Is this about shooting up a school?
Oh, man.
So, they're singing this song, and I was going to be like, hey, let's get a clip from YouTube and have it converted to MP3. But it's just such a small clip. I figured I'll just play it through my phone. I know the audio isn't as good, but I'll play it here so you get an idea about this song. Here we go. Here comes this part.
Goodbye, Papa. Please pray for me. I was the black sheep of the family. You tried to teach me right from wrong. Too much wine and too much song. Wonder how I got along. Goodbye, Papa, it's hard to die when all the birds are singing in the sky. Now that the spring's in the air, little children everywhere, when you see them, I'll be there. We had joy, we had fun, we had seasons in the sun, but the wine and the song, like the seasons, have all gone. We had joy, we had fun, we had seasons in the sun, but the wine and the song, like the seasons, have all gone. Goodbye, Michelle, my little one.
Jeez, how sad. How depressing.
It's very haunting.
Yeah, it is.
So after eating their burgers and fries, the three of them leave the OK restaurant in order to search for a place for Joey to die, with Joey completely oblivious to the fact for the third time. On this day, which was July 28th of 1974, the north side of Market Street there extended from 8th Street to 10th Street. And on this day, that entire place was a demolition area. Pretty much all the buildings and shops on that side were either partially or completely torn down. So it was kind of looked like, at this point in time, the Gaza Strip.
Oof. Oof.
Joe, Michael, and Joey start walking through the rubble. And at one point in the walk, little Joey points out the remains of a single-story brick building at 927 Market Street. Now, that building had, at one time in the 50s and 60s, been a novelty shop called Goldman's. And that area is now a mall-esque building full of, like, clothing and retail stores and, of course, a Starbucks. I think a Starbucks can only be built on a place of pain and blood. So... Now, the front wall of this building here of Goldman's was completely torn down. So imagine, like, you just chopped a building in half, which exposed the insides. You could look into the inside of the building. On seeing this, Joey said, quote, "Let's go in there."
It's like, he's an idiot, Mac. He's like, I think he wants to die.
It's fucking Mr. Magoo.
Oh, man. Okay.
The three of them went into this, like, destroyed building. And at the back of what was left of the store, they find an old iron door that was jarred open. They had discovered the dark, unlit basement of Goldman's, which you had to get down to via a creepy-ass, rusted, ancient spiral staircase. Like one of those kind of corkscrew.
Yeah. It's like when they were building it, they were like, what would be the creepiest staircase we can put in this? I know. And then they put that in there.
Joey sees this, the basement, and turns around, and behind him is standing Joe and Michael, kind of forming a blockade. He looks back at the dark basement that led down into a creepy dungeon, and back at two people that have tried to kill him twice, and then back at the dark, creepy door. I don't know if he's starting to put two and two together here, but he says, quote, I'm going down. After hearing that Joey was going down to the basement voluntarily, Joe pulls the three flashlights from the bag that he had brought and passes them out and says, quote,
all right, Joey, let's go down and see what's there.
With Joey leading the way to his murder, Joe and Michael follow him down the spiral circular steel staircase. But halfway down, they hit water. And in this, Joe has a rock hard erection. His dick starts getting hard.
Of course.
It's murder time.
Yeah.
Turns out this basement, it had been, the front facade of it had been missing for a while during this demolition and the rain and everything. This basement was flooded. Like, really flooded. It was 5 foot deep of water. 5 foot of water in this dark, creepy basement. And this was hot, stagnant, slimy water. So they're standing halfway up this steel case at the water level, looking with flashlights in this creepy old basement full of water, and realized that to the left of the steps was the top of a large steel cabinet peeking out of the water. Joey, now standing at the water level looking in, and turn around, looks up the steps. He's blocked by Mike and Joe. Looks back at the water and says, quote, I'm getting in.
They don't even have to kill him, really. They just have to follow him. I mean, I don't even think they have to follow the kid.
And then Joey jumps in to the hot, stagnant, slimy water and just starts flopping and wading around and playing in it. Meanwhile, Joe and Michael are staying on the steps. They want to stay dry. Joe sits down on the steps, takes his shoes and socks off, and rolls up his pant legs. Now, sitting on this steel cabinet that's to the left of them is a 6 foot wooden ladder. Michael and Joe notice it at the same time, and they nod to each other like, hey, that's what we need right there.
Remind me really quick, how old's Michael again?
Michael is 14.
Okay, so he's just a titch older than Joey.
Yes.
Okay.
Joey's 13.
Okay.
When they see the ladder, Joe yells for Joey, who's frolicking around in the dirty, stagnant, gross water. Hey, come back to the steps, Joey. And Joey does. When he gets there, Joe and Michael stand that ladder up against the wall on top of the cabinet. And they say, hey, Joey, get on this ladder and then turn around. We're going to get the camera and we're going to get some really cool pictures of you. Just turn around and stand on this ladder. We're going to get some cool pictures of you. And Joey says, hell yeah. Climbs onto this steel cabinet, gets on the ladder that's propped up on top of it, climbs about halfway up the ladder, and then turns around. So his back is against the ladder. He's a couple rungs up, waiting to get some cool pictures of him standing on this ladder. At this point, Joe pulls the chains and locks from the bag. And Joey stands there diligently while Joe and Michael chains his arms and legs to the ladder behind him. So now Joey is on this ladder looking down at 5 foot of stagnant water in a dark, dingy, gross basement. with his arms and legs chained to this ladder, so he can't move his arms or legs. When he looks down and realizes he's being chained, the whole situation, he says, "These are going to be some cool pictures."
I think even like moving into adulthood, Joey might have struggled with the fact that he trusted too much. I don't think he could have been a criminal for that. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you can't trust as much as this guy trusts and succeed. Somebody's going to get him.
I think we all know where this is going. I don't have to say it, but I will. They never intended to use that camera. After Joey's chained, it's getting ready to give. I know we've been like busting Joey's balls a lot and joking around, but it's legit getting ready to be fucked up because Michael and Joe each grab a corner of the ladder, and as you guessed it, they push it forward. The ladder topples forward off of the cabinet with Joey strapped to it face first into 5 foot of stagnant water. It bobs like a fishing floater there and rocks back and forth because on the other side of it, with his head underwater, Joey is trying to fight against the chains. Michael and Joe, standing there on the steps, watch Joey drown. And while he's drowning, Joe has an orgasm.
What? I mean, I'm not surprised, I guess, but... Jeez.
Joey was able to get his little head up out of the water just one time and was only able to get it up for just a second. Joe said later that he spit out some slimy hot water, and the only thing he was able to get out before his head went back underwater was, "Daddy, help me."
Oh. Jeez.
Right after Joe had his orgasm, his penis went soft, and you guessed what happened. All the urges once again went away. He no longer wanted Joey to die. All the urges were gone. It was cut off. It was like cutting the head off the snake the second his penis went soft. But it was too late. The ladder wasn't moving anymore. It was just floating in the darkness there in the water in the basement. In a panic, Joe leaps from the staircase into the water and wades over and quickly flips the ladder over. But Joey's dead. He pulls Joey from the chains, unlocks him, takes his body, drags it to the staircase, sits down, and holds Joey for a bit. Meanwhile, Michael, still looking at this from the criminal aspect of things, takes the ladder, removes the chains, and puts them back in the bag, and then throws the ladder in another part of the basement there. He then says to Joe, "Get up! We gotta get out of here! He's dead! That's what we wanted!" Joe, agreeing with Michael, then laid Joey's body on the steel steps at the bottom. The deed had been done. And there was no taking it back now. The two of them go home. When they got home, Joe went upstairs for the rest of the day and just kind of zoned out, while Mike played outside with his friends. Just murdered his brother. At 11 p.m. that night, after eating a dinner of pizza with his family, Joe calls the police and reports Joey is missing. On Friday, August 10th, 1974, at 2:20 a.m., this is almost a month later. No, it was about, 2 weeks? A little over 2 weeks later, Joey's badly decomposed body is found in the basement by construction workers. Now, this was confusing to them at first. Because as the body had been down there, you know, rotting, they had continued demolition around that place and that building itself. And a lot of, like, debris and concrete and wood had fallen on the corpse over the next few weeks.
Yeah.
So when they found him, they assumed in the beginning that he had been down there playing and had been pinned during the demolition. Because they don't know when this debris fell, right? They just thought, oh, shit, like, we accidentally killed this kid or what. They don't really know what's going on. But the cause of death couldn't be determined by the mortician. Decomposition was advanced. Joe Callinger did go to the morgue and identify the body by the pants that were on it. He didn't see the body. He saw pictures of Joey's corpse, but not the body. They showed him the clothes, and he identified the pants that Joey were wearing because of, I'm not making this up, the charred bottoms from the fire in the trailer.
Well, that's my son. Yeah, those charred bottoms, pants are from our second attempt to kill. I mean... Yeah, I think that's my son.
Yeah, that's our boy, old Fire Britches. We called him.
Friday, August 16th, 1974, was the day of Joey Callinger's funeral. Michael and Joe remained straight-faced the whole funeral, while Betty, the mother, was a complete and total fucking mess, like you would be.
Yeah.
Joey's body was buried next to the body of Stephen Callinger, if you remember him from part one, Joe's father, the abuser that abused Joe growing up.
Yeah.
And just to let you know how disgusting Anna Callinger was, Joe's mom, while standing there at the cemetery, Anna Callinger starts cursing the coffin in German and shaking her hand at it because... he had stolen her burial plot. She was supposed to be buried next to Stephen.
Ugh.
And Joey had fucked around and got murdered and taken it from her. Now, if you remember, while they were trying to kill Joey, Joe had taken out a life insurance policy. The John Hancock Life Insurance Company, though, refused to honor the life insurance claim because they suspected foul play.
What?
You got to keep in mind, man, that just a few years prior, not even years, this is pretty recent, Joe had been accused of child abuse and did time for it.
Yeah, yeah.
And only got off of it after the kids recanted their claims.
Another thing, question, and maybe I missed this, but were there no chains or anything connected to his decomposed?
Oh, yeah, I covered that. Remember, Michael went in while Joe was holding Joey's body and took the chains from the ladder. He cleaned up everything, put it back in the bag. They brought it home with him.
At that point, I was still stuck on the fact that he had climaxed. That I missed that. I apologize.
No, you're fine.
Just the climax part was just too much.
Yeah, it's a lot. It's a lot. On an early morning of September 26, 1974, Joe and Betty are awakened by knocking at the door. When Joe opens it, it's the Philadelphia Police Department. And they drag Joe down to the Roundhouse Police Station at 750 Ray Street. This police station, I know this isn't important to the story, but it's really cool looking. It looks like handcuffs from the sky. That's why they call it the Roundhouse.
Huh.
At 750 Ray Street. And in 2021, I believe... they moved the police station to another building, so that building is now empty. And there's a bunch of hoo-ha going on as we speak about what to do with that building because they say history of police brutality, blah, 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 blah. But, and there is, to be fair enough, but, like, the building, like, do something cool with it. Like, it's a really cool building if you look at it. Make it an art installation. Make it a wall. Not a Walmart. Make it a Starbucks.
Yeah, there. That's
because the police brutality, that should be enough pain and suffering, right, for a Starbucks to flourish.
Yeah, I think so.
The police were certain that Joe Callinger had killed Joey Callinger, and he had. But they didn't have any evidence whatsoever. So all they could hope for was a confession. Now, they had chosen this day in particular, September 26, 1974, because Joe's lawyer, a man by the name of Art Gudkin, was Jewish. On this day, this was some kind of Jewish holiday, and they knew his lawyer was less likely to be working. So they were hoping they could violate his civil rights. More of a testament to kind of police not going by the book, abusing their power.
Yeah, real solid. Yeah.
In interrogation room 103, homicide detective Lieutenant James O'Neill starts trying to grill Joe. And as stupid as Joe is, he very quickly requests his lawyer, refuses to say anything. And that ends that. Joe's lawyer, Art Gunkin, despite the fact that it was a Jewish holiday for him, does show up a few moments later and shuts the whole damn thing down. Now, I know this all seems like it isn't worth mentioning. Like, maybe I could have just said, hey, they got suspicious and nothing happened, though. This does show that the police are on his tail, but one more important thing does come out of this. Because while walking home from this attempted police interrogation, a flatbed truck is driving beside him on the street. It was traffic. There was heavy traffic. And on the back of that flatbed truck op was a little carousel, a miniature carousel. At one point, Joe looks over and notices the top of a little boy's head behind one of the wooden horses on that carousel. It had wavy brown hair. And Joe thought, that's weird. Why would there be a child riding a carousel in the back of a moving truck? And he keeps walking. And it's funny that of all the things Joe has seen, this is what he thinks is weird. But I digress. When he gets home, he enters through the shop and begins fumbling for his keys in his pocket as he climbs the steps to the front door of his apartment. And a few steps from the front door, he looks up. And the head of that little boy there that he had seen on the carousel is now hovering in front of the door to his apartment.
Oh.
And this is when he realizes it doesn't have a body.
Yeah.
It's just a head hovering in the air. It was a young boy's head with white skin and long brown hair. Joe said it had no mouth, nose, or nostrils, and that the eyes were just white. White eyes.
Okay.
Joe screamed when he saw it and threw his keys at it. But of course, this head isn't solid. It was in Joe's imagination. The keys passed straight through the head and hit the door to the apartment. And that's when his wife swung open the door, the head vanished, and she screamed, quote, "Who is throwing things at my door?" Only to discover Joe standing there alone. Now, this shakes Joe up a bit. And later that night, Joe is sitting at his workbench in the shop. He's pulling the sole off of a shoe. When he hears a voice behind him. Now, I want to point out something here. I'm literally doing an impression right now of how the book described this character's voice sounding.
Okay.
It isn't theatrics. I know it sounds like a lot of my impressions because I'm bad at impressions and voices. But this time, it is actually fitting.
Okay.
From behind him, Joe heard, quote, "My name's Charlie."
Okay.
Joe spun around in his chair and hovering underneath the shelf, stacked with shoes, was that same head that he had seen earlier that day. Ladies and gentlemen, Charlie has just entered the fucking chat, and Charlie is a character.
Oh my gosh, another Another voice in his head.
Joe reached out and tried to touch Charlie's face, but he vanished and reappeared by the door. The conversation that followed went like this.
You have no mouth. How can you talk?
I can talk! Look!
What do you want? Where do you come from?
Charlie didn't say anything. And on this, Joe screams,
Why don't you answer me?
When Joey screamed at Charlie, his bangs closed over his eyes like he was shutting Joe out. And that's when Joe's wife, Betty, yelled, Joe, who are you talking to in there? Joe turned back to Charlie and said, quote,
Listen, that's my wife. She'll see you. Go away for God's sake.
Don't worry, Joe. Betty'll never see me. No one else will either. Only you.
How come you know my wife's name?
'Cause I belong to you, and you belong to me.
You're my sweetheart. That's actually what Charlie said. It's the lyrics to that song, but that's what he said.
I belong to you. You belong to me.
After answering this question, Charlie's hair parted again, showing his eyes like he's, okay, I'm not mad at you anymore for yelling at me. Joe said, quote,
I never did anything to you. Why are you bothering me? I can't live this way. I can't.
And that's when Joe put his face down on the desk and began crying. When he looked back up, Charlie was gone. This is the night, Op, that Joe Callinger met Charlie. And Charlie will haunt Joe regularly for the next 2 years.
This is the thing that it really intrigues me about these kind of mental illnesses, is that he seems reluctant to have this guy present, you know?
Yeah.
But he's making it up, you know, himself.
You know, they say a lot of things. There's a lot of downsides to schizophrenia.
Yeah, there.
But it's never boring. And it's never lonely.
It's true. Oh my gosh.
We're going to get to know Charlie a whole lot more in part four. And part four is also where we're going to close the story on Joe Callinger, the Shoemaker. Because that's a wrap for part three of our Joseph Callinger series. I'm excited to close the story and be done with the cobbler. That's all. Jeez, I got.
Charlie. I'm going to wager that Charlie does a lot of damage.
He does. And he really runs his fucking mouth a lot, too.
I'm excited to hear a whole episode of you.
Charlie's a shit talker.
A whole episode of you talking like that.
You got a little bit, Joe.
You better bring some throat lozenges. Wow. Well, okay. Onward and inward toward episode four of this. I'm excited. I'm not.
I am too. Excited to be done with this. You know, I added it up last night. By the time this series is done, the entirety of the, like, if you took the part one of Joe Callinger and part four of Callinger and added it all together, the outline would be a total of just over 150 pages.
Wow. 150 pages. That's a lot of ChatGPT.
Almost as long as your manifesto.
My root beer and buffalo chicken pizza manifesto.
That's all I got up. Don't forget to write and review or don't or whatever. We had fun. We had joy. We had fun. We had seasons in the sun.
I love you.
Fuck you.